Welcome to our Reading the Bible class. We're on a journey that I hope will lead you into a lifelong habit of reading your Bible every day. Today, I want to talk about the importance of obedience and how it relates to our Bible reading. We'll be looking at a passage from Luke chapter 6, verses 46 through 49. Jesus says, "Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and not do the things which I say? Whoever comes to me and hears my sayings and does them, I will show you whom he is like. He is like a man building a house who dug deep and laid the foundation on the rock. And when the flood arose, the stream beat vehemently against that house and could not shake it, for it was founded on the rock. But he who heard and did nothing is like a man who built his house on the earth without a foundation, against which the stream beat vehemently, and immediately it fell, and the ruin of that house was great." So Jesus said, "Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and not do the things which I say?" The word for Lord in Greek is kurios, and it means he to whom a person or thing belongs, about which he has power of deciding. It can be translated master or Lord. And you know, we really don't understand this title, Lord, as Americans. I mean, we are the nation that was formed when we rebelled against the King of England. We tend to live by the motto, "You ain't the boss of me." And yet many of us claim that Jesus is now our Lord. We need to be careful that we don't use that term lightly, but that we think about what we're saying. And so Jesus said, "Whoever comes to me and hears my sayings and does them, I will show you whom he is like. He is like a man building a house who dug deep and laid the foundation on the rock. And when the flood arose, the stream beat vehemently against that house and could not shake it, for it was founded on the rock." He laid the foundation on the rock. Now, one of the ways of looking at this parable of Jesus is to think of it in terms of floods or storms that we will face in life. I'm going to call the lesson here Storm Watch, because the storms are indeed coming. I'm not sure we have any actual weather storms in our near-term forecast, but there are other storms we face. Let me tell you about storms in my life this last week. Last week was a difficult week for us. Our beloved father-in-law, my beloved father-in-law, unexpectedly passed away on Sunday evening, October 31st. That alone was enough. That alone was difficult. Deb and I were the first family members to make it to the house, and we were there as the paramedics, police, and the coroner arrived. On the following Tuesday morning, we're at the mortuary, beginning to make funeral plans. On Wednesday afternoon, I'm teaching my Bible college class in Thessalonians, and I make several statements during the class along the lines of saying something like, "When we go through difficult times, people have a chance to see what we're really like. People can see what it's like to trust Jesus." Well, sometimes I regret saying those kinds of things because then I get tested on it. I'm teasing. On that same Wednesday, I get a call from my dermatologist saying that they want me to come in the next day and talk to the doctor about the results of a biopsy. So I'm driving to the doctor on Thursday morning. I'm in my car and a song starts to play.
"Well, there's a storm that's coming. I place my faith in you. A storm is coming. I place my faith in you. 'Cause when that storm is coming, there ain't nothing else that I can do."
So the lyrics start with, "There's a storm that's coming. I place my faith in you," Mac Powell. Now, this kind of stuff doesn't always happen with me, but I had the sense that as I'm driving, that God was speaking to me, and I needed to be ready for the storm that was coming. So I walk into my doctor's office and get the news that I've got melanoma, and I'm going to need surgery immediately the following Monday. Later that day, I received a call from a good friend who's been in the hospital and he's just been diagnosed with stage 4 cancer of the stomach and pancreas. That evening, we dive into the funeral events that last for the next couple of days, a viewing, the funeral, the graveside, and I'm the one leading them all. On the following Monday, I have surgery to remove the melanoma. Now, I'm not sharing this to get your sympathy, and I know that some of you are going through way worse storms than those I've faced. But I'm glad that the Lord reminded me about the storms that were coming. And I'd like to just report to you, my house is still standing. Jesus is still Lord, and we will make it through. Jesus didn't say, if a flood comes, but when the flood arose, we will all go through floods and storms. It could be the loss of your job. It could be the loss of a loved one by death or a broken relationship. It could be the loss of your health. Living well in this life is not a matter of avoiding the storms, but learning to survive them. And how you survive those difficult times is related to how you are building your life. Remember that old story, the three little pigs? You know, the first pig wants to spend his time playing rather than building, so he builds his house out of straw. And the big bad wolf comes and, yeah, well, you remember the story. What a great story. If you don't build your life with the right things, how are you going to survive when the wolf attacks? Jesus wasn't talking about pigs and wolves, but about storms and builders. How you choose to build will affect how you will survive. So what could the house represent? It could be your life, your goals in life, what you do with your life. Could be your family, how you choose your spouse, how you handle your marriage, how you raise your kids. Jesus has challenged his listeners to understand what it means to call him Lord. In Jesus' story, the two builders both started off with the same potential. They both heard the teaching of Jesus. It's kind of like they both had been reading their Bibles. How the builders fared in the storm depended on what they did with what they read or heard. One person obeyed what Jesus said, like the man who built on the rock, while the other person didn't obey, like the man who built on the sand. So let me just talk a little bit about the benefits of lordship. Don't forget that our passage started with Jesus talking about calling him Lord. And when it comes to discussing the lordship of Jesus in our lives, some of us tend to groan a little inside. All we can think about is how hard it is or that all of our fun is just going to go away. The truth is, There are huge benefits to learning to live in obedience to Jesus. It starts when we learn to believe in Jesus. John 6:28, then they said to him, "What shall we do that we may work the works of God?" And Jesus answered and said to them, "This is the work of God. This is what you need to do to obey, that you believe in him whom he sent." Jesus said, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." Jesus came to this earth to be a sacrifice. He came to die for our sins. He came to pay the penalty for our sins. The way you get his payment applied to your life is doing what he says, which is to believe. Open your heart to Jesus and believe. That's the first step of obedience to Jesus. And what's that benefit that comes? It's everlasting life. That's pretty good. But it continues with obeying him. In James chapter 1, verse 21, James writes, "So get rid of all the filth and evil in your lives and humbly accept the word God has planted in your hearts. And for it has the power to save your souls." But don't just listen to God's word. You must do what it says. Otherwise, you are only fooling yourselves. For if you listen to the word and don't obey, it is like glancing at your face in a mirror. You see yourself, walk away, and forget what you look like. But if you look carefully into the perfect law that sets you free, and if you do what it says and don't forget what you heard, then God will bless you for doing it. Believing in Jesus, it gets you into heaven. But we also need help in this life, on this planet, surviving the very real storms that are ahead of us. This comes from obedience. What's the benefit of obedience? James says God will bless you for it. There are good things that result, like even surviving the storm. Jesus said in John 14:21, "He who has my commandments and keeps them, it is he who loves me, and he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him." So one of the blessings that comes from obeying God is greater intimacy with Jesus. He will manifest, he will reveal himself in a greater, deeper way. All this to say, it starts with reading your Bible, but it is so important that we learn to do what it says. And I hope this whets your appetite to be reading and applying God's word every day.